next on Unsolved Mysteries. Authorities rule that a young woman has drowned accidentally. But eyewitness accounts, missing evidence, and a cryptic phone call suggests it was murder. A gravely wounded Vietnam vet who was close to dying searches for the Army nurse who gave him a reason to live. Two hitchhikers unknowingly catch a ride with a murder suspect. But when they try to report him, nobody listens. And our viewers help capture a Tennessee man accused of murdering two teenage girls. Some hot cases, some cold cases, and some cases that will even shock you. I'm Dennis Farina, and this is Unsolved Mysteries. Fayetteville, North Carolina. The day after Christmas. After completing her shift at the hospital, Debbie Wolf left work, presumably heading home.
The next morning, Debbie should have been at work. She had to be at work at 8. Debbie did not go to work. Debbie did not answer her telephone. It wasn't like Debbie at all. She never missed work. She would call in if she was even going to be a few minutes late.
Debbie's parents and a family friend named Kevin Gorton hurried over to her house, an isolated cabin 4 miles outside of Fayetteville.
Debbie's car was not parked where she always parked it.
But look at the seat. That seat's pushed way back.
We looked around and we saw beer cans laying in the yard.
She never drank that kind anyway.
Dogs were running loose, but they had not been fed.
It's been a while since I've gone.
Debbie!
There were small things that were out of place that Debbie would not have put where they were placed. There was a uniform laying on the floor in the kitchen, things thrown in the kitchen on the floor, like maybe she took them off.
Debbie's purse was not in its usual place. Kevin found it shoved under the bed.
Purse, it is.
Hey, Deb, missed you here at work today.
There was also an odd message on Debbie's answering machine, recorded earlier that day.
Been out a lot of days. You make me worry when you miss another one. Just want to.
What concerned
me
about his message was that he said that she had missed a lot of days at work, and she hadn't. In fact, she had only missed a few hours at work at the time that he put the message on the answering machine.
The search continued outside the cabin and around a nearby pond, but there was no sign of Debbie Wolf. Debbie's mother called the sheriff's office and was told they would investigate only after Debbie had been missing for 3 days. But 5 days would pass before authorities began a full-scale search.
They searched the cabin. Later that afternoon, they brought the bloodhounds out, which they could find nothing at all. They then walked around the edge of the pond. I was there for that.
Friends of the family had been there a couple of days prior, had done some searching on their own. They had already looked in the pond. There was no use for us to look in the pond, so I don't think we did a dive of the pond or a complete search of the pond on that day. No, we did not.
At that time, I asked him if it would be all right then if I got my own divers to go into the pond, and he said certainly.
Kevin Gorton and another friend, Gordon Childress, returned to the pond. Both men were familiar with rescue work. Childress dragged the pond looking for evidence.
Kevin, I found what looks like a set of tracks.
He was in the water approximately 2 minutes when he called out to me and told me that he had found what looked like a set of footprints and a drag mark.
In fact, Gordon Childress says that he found two sets of footprints pressed into the thick mud along with drag marks.
I
went out and went under and following the trail. I was maybe 6 inches from the bottom. I hit something and my mask flooded.
It looks like a body down here.
Are you sure?
Let me double check.
So I went back down, confirmed the hole, spent more time looking, didn't touch or disturb anything. I couldn't see above mid-drift. It was inside of a, looked like a burn barrel. It was a rusty 55-gallon oil drum type thing with holes in it.
Police were called to the scene. The dead woman was identified as Debbie Wolf.
The coroner concluded that Debbie Wolf had drowned. An autopsy revealed no trace of drugs, no alcohol in her system, no obvious signs of foul play. But evidence at the scene and a mysterious phone call led Debbie's family and friends to believe that she was murdered.
Kevin, why don't you come over here and identify the body?
A typical cold water drowning will be eyes open, mouth open, hands and arms in a very clawed state, you know, just a fight for life, which was quite on contrary to the way that Debbie was. The eyes were closed, the mouth was closed, arms were in a relaxed state, just her whole body was relaxed. She looked like she was asleep.
We theorized that if it was an accidental drowning, she may have been out around the pond. Possibly she was playing with the dogs and fell in.
As the investigation continued, police began to deny that Debbie's body had been found inside of a barrel.
I asked, do they have the barrel? And they said, no, they decided to leave it there. They'll get it in the morning. The next day, they went back to get the barrel. It seems that the barrel was gone. All of a sudden, it didn't exist. The same barrel that had been there the night before.
In my opinion, and opinions of some of the investigators, what appeared to be a barrel to some of the divers could have been the field jacket, which may have ballooned out as she was laying at that angle at the bottom of the pond.
There was no doubt in my mind, 100% positive, that it was an old burn barrel or something of that nature. You know, metal rusted 55-gallon type drum, you know, that the body was in.
There was an oil barrel. It was sitting by Debbie's cabin. We used it for target practice. After I had called law enforcement that we had located a body, I went over to the spot where the barrel was. The barrel was no longer there.
A few months later, Jenny discovered another inconsistency.
When I got a chance to examine the clothes that were on Debbie's body, I realized that those were not Debbie's clothes. The bra was cup size, three sizes too large for her. The pants were very, very much too long. The shoes, Debbie wore a lady's size 7, and these were a men's size 6.
The tennis shoes she had on were her tennis shoes. We have photographs of her with those tennis shoes on prior to her death. And that's as much as I want to comment on the clothing.
Debbie's family remained convinced that she had been murdered. Among Debbie's responsibilities at work was coordinating the hospital's volunteers.
Come on, I want to go out with you.
I don't want to go out with you. I've told you.
One volunteer in particular seemed to bother her quite a bit because he had a history of psychiatric illnesses.
You wait here.
Wait a minute.
According to Debbie's mother, one volunteer had obtained Debbie's home phone number.
Hello.
He was investigated by the sheriff's department the night that the body was brought to the surface. However, he provided an alibi and refused to take a polygraph. So he wasn't questioned any longer. He left several days after that to go out of state.
He did.
There was another volunteer at the hospital at the same time that wanted to become romantically involved with Debbie. Debbie discussed this with everyone, including him, and told him that she would be his friend, but nothing else. She was interested in someone else, totally away from the hospital.
You know I've got a boyfriend.
Jenny is convinced that this was the man who called Debbie the day after she disappeared, expressing concern that she had been missing from work for days.
Make me worry when you miss another one.
There was nothing there that we could use in any criminal prosecution, or there was nothing there that to indicate to us that this was a homicide.
What really happened to Debbie Wolf? Her mother believes that she was taken hostage and then murdered. She believes that later, someone returned to the pond to remove the barrel so that the death would seem accidental.
And there are people out there who know what happened to Debbie. And I'm hoping that they will come forward and finally say something. She was loved by very, very many people. And I think that she has a right to be put to rest, finally. And I'd like to do that.
If you have any information about the death of Debbie Wolf, please log on to our website at unsolved.com. Coming up, a Vietnam vet tries to find the Army nurse who healed him, both physically and emotionally. Only 1 week after Jim Bukowski got married to his high school sweetheart, he was shipped off to Vietnam.
We landed, and we're all scared. It's the unknown. Didn't know what I was getting into. Had no idea.
In 1968, Jim was seriously injured by enemy fire. Jim Bukowski had experiences most of us can hardly imagine. Jim did his best to forget them, but he did preserve one memory, a nurse named Linda Sharp, who gave him the will to live.
Captain Sharp was the only good memory I had. She had something about her that made you feel comfortable, warm, want to live, and go back home when you were dying.
Just 2 days before he was to be reunited with his new bride in Hawaii, Jim's platoon was attacked by a group of North Vietnamese.
They blew us to smithereens. We didn't even have a chance. There were 60 of us, somewhere between 250 and 300 of them. And it wiped out my whole company. At the time, I was operating the radio for Lieutenant because we were two people side by side. He was dead. And then the next thing I knew, I went flying through the air. I landed 30 feet down the hill. I picked up my leg that was blown off, and I crawled back up the hill.
Hey, coming through, we got a patient. Coming through. I don't know if he's coming in or not, I don't know. Okay.
It looks bad.
Give me
some suture. My first conscious memory was looking up and seeing this blonde lady in fatigues helping me.
You'll be fine, soldier. You'll be fine.
Captain Linda Sharp. I just woke up and opened my eyes and she was looking over me.
We need a doctor back over here.
I heard people talking, and he ain't gonna make it. And all I saw was her looking down at me. She gave me the encouragement to live.
Because of extreme infection, What was left of Jim's leg was amputated at the hip. This was followed by frigid baths to lower his body temperature.
Hi, Jim. How you doing? Going for a little swim?
The lady was phenomenal.
Hey, you know, we need a hurry up.
But every time I'd open my eyes, that lady's blue eyes would be looking down at me.
Looks like you're feeling better. Hey, I promise if you get your temperature down, I can take you out and go get a couple beers. Sounds good. I promise that's what I'm gonna do. If you weren't cold before.
With her help, Jim regained his former spirit and his will to live.
Want to go dancing when we get back home?
You know it. I'm dancing the night away.
What are you doing?
You'll see. Be quiet.
Late one night, just 2 days before Jim was scheduled to leave, Captain Sharp kept her word.
Do I keep my promises?
Wow.
Stars were out. Beautiful night.
My own stock.
And she brought two cans of beer, popped them both, sat on the edge of the bed, and smiled.
So, you gonna write your wife about your leg?
I don't know how.
You started with one word at a time.
I just don't know what to say to her.
You were not allowed to leave the MASH unit until you wrote a letter to your wife. I didn't have the courage to write it. She forced me to do it. And then I didn't know she had sent a letter and a picture to my wife with it, telling my wife what to expect.
Dear Mrs. Bukowski, it truly is not possible for me, a poor letter writer, to tell you how very much Jim loves you. There will be days when Jim will be discouraged, but don't you or any of your families ever feel sorry for him. He needs understanding, love, and help, not pity. A missing limb doesn't make Jim less of a person, and it certainly doesn't lessen his love for you.
Take care, Jim.
God bless you both. Sincerely, Captain Linda Sharp.
I just think about her. I've thought about her since the day I left Vietnam. I don't think that I would have came back to my wife without Captain Sharp. She just gave me all the encouragement and the strength and the motivation to live.
Jim was awarded 2 Purple Hearts for wounds sustained in combat and a Silver Star for his bravery under fire. But Jim's war raged on, silently.
He didn't want people to know he was a Vietnam veteran. He would just assume people thought his leg was lost in a car accident or something.
For 20 years, Jim suffered from post-traumatic stress disorder, but the memory of Captain Linda Sharp's kindness helped him to heal.
He's ready to look for her now, because now he's well enough mentally to look for her, and I think if he could meet her, it might help him to heal.
I would very much like to get in touch with Captain Linda Sharp, if it's at all possible, and thank her for what she did for me. And all the other guys.
Update. Linda Sharp saw Jim's story on Unsolved Mysteries, and she immediately called us. 2 weeks later, she and Jim were reunited.
Hi.
Hi.
How are you?
Good. How are you?
Come here.
I couldn't believe it. You look so good. You really do.
When I opened the door, I was elated. All I wanted to do was give her a great big hug and just hug her and thank her and kiss her on the cheek and just try to show my appreciation.
I feel very blessed to be here, to actually see him and talk with him, because sometimes nurses don't realize that we have an impact on patients' lives, and I certainly didn't realize the impact I had on his life at all.
Jim Bukowski remained in contact with Linda Sharp Caldwell until his death, 9 years after their reunion. Coming up, police hunt for a cold-blooded killer of a frail elderly man. In Washburn, Texas, Bill Henderson says goodbye to his wife, granddaughter, and great-granddaughter.
I'll take care of you till Saturday when I see you again, okay?
I'll be fine.
I love you.
They were heading off to visit relatives several hundred miles away. Over the next 3 days, Bill stayed in touch, and then a day went by with no word from Bill.
Every time I called, it was just a busy signal, so I didn't really know if the phones were just off the hook or what happened.
We was afraid that maybe he may have had a heart attack or some health problem and was sick in the house and couldn't get to the telephone, or maybe had been trying to call for help and dropped the telephone or something like that. That's what we was afraid of.
Bill's son, Gary, and two other family members were worried about Bill. They immediately drove to his house.
His truck's not out front. I don't know where he is.
Dad?
When we arrived at my dad's house, the phone in the kitchen was off the hook. My brother-in-law, Frank, went over and hung that phone up. I was walking down the hall, saw my dad's glasses, broken glasses, laying in the floor. There was a picture laying in the floor. And that's when I saw my father laying in the floor and the room all tore up.
Frank!
He was cold. He'd been there for a while, and Frank told me that he didn't think my dad died of a heart attack, that it looked like he was murdered.
Bill Henderson had been strangled and beaten to death with an electric iron 8 to 10 hours before he was found.
This was an extremely violent murder. The man was beaten time and time again. And it was extremely obvious to us also that Mr. Henderson had put up a fight for his life.
Bill's truck and wallet were missing, and yet police weren't convinced that robbery could be the motivation for such a brutal crime. 5 days after the murder, a man walking along an interstate highway some 50 miles from Washburn came across Henderson's wallet. And then more evidence turned up. The next day, Bill Henderson's pickup truck was discovered just outside of Chicago, more than 1,000 miles from Washburn, Texas. Police found no clues in the pickup, but they did learn about two important eyewitnesses who not only met the killer, but actually spent the day riding with him in Henderson's truck. On the day of the murder, 265 miles east of Washburn, three young men arrived at a truck stop. To the attendant, it was soon obvious that something was wrong.
Excuse me, you gotta do something. That guy stole a pickup truck.
What?
They started telling him that the truck they were in that the man had stolen.
Pickup truck?
Out there, the brown one. You gotta do something. Is it you? 8861, Texas.
It's not reported stolen. Okay, thanks. I'm sorry, guys. They said it's not stolen.
It's gotta be stolen.
They said no.
The problem we had was that when they ran the license plate number on the truck, we had yet to find Mr. Henderson's body.
15 minutes later, the driver of the pickup truck left. The hitchhikers refused to go with him.
After the suspect drove off, they were still so insistent on trying to get this man picked up, so scared of him, that they went and dialed 911 themselves, trying to get someone to stop the suspect in the truck.
Yeah, I'd like to report a stolen vehicle.
Again, sheriff's deputies said that no such vehicle had been reported missing. According to the attendant, the two hitchhikers then headed towards the highway. They never gave authorities their names or their addresses. The suspect continued north. He abandoned the pickup truck 24 hours later in Hazel Crest, Illinois, just south of Chicago.
I think it's extremely important that we catch this man. Anybody that will attack an elderly man that is nearly defenseless because of natural disease and illnesses will attack and kill anybody.
It hurts to know what Bill had to go through, the pain and suffering he had to go through out there before he took his last breath. And I would just like to see this person caught and tried, convicted, and sentenced.
I don't feel like my dad should have had to see something like that leaning over him, you know, as the last thing he ever saw. It just wasn't fair.
Who murdered Bill Henderson? Police had only one clue that could provide an answer.
There was a palm print in blood inside the room. It was on a art-type tablet. If we can find the person that matches up to that bloody palm print, then we have our murder suspect.
Update. As a result of our broadcast, the two hitchhikers came forward. Under hypnosis, they recalled details about the suspect, including his hometown and his first name. That information led police to Lawrence Tutt, who by that time was serving time in Ohio for an unrelated crime. DNA evidence linked Tutt to the murder of Bill Henderson, and Tutt pleaded guilty. He was sentenced to 45 years in a Texas prison. Next, teenage girls who spent time with Joe Shepherd kept turning up dead. But before police could get a straight answer from them, Joe Shepherd was on the run. Tellico Plains, Tennessee. In a parked car, 16-year-old Roxanne Woodson fights off the advances of a man named Joe Shepherd. Two friends watch from the back seat. Roxanne escapes and runs off into the darkness. Shepherd chases after her. Roxanne Woodson doesn't return that night or during the ensuing days.
We just fell on our knees and said, "Oh God, no, oh God, no, not her."
Roxanne's disappearance was traumatic not only for her family, but also for investigators on the case. They suspected that Joe Shepherd, the last person seen with Roxanne, might be able to explain how she vanished. Shortly after Roxanne was reported missing, police went to the house where Joe Shepherd lived with his parents. The officers waited while Shepherd went into his bedroom to put on his boots. Suddenly, Shepherd reached for a shotgun. The officers wrestled the gun away from Shepherd and took him in for questioning.
When was the last time you saw Roxanne Woodson?
Joe's initial story was that he had attempted to seduce Roxanne, and she had gotten mad at him at his persistent efforts and had jumped from the car and run into the woods, that he went running after her. And finally, Joe came back telling the two boys that he'd tried to get her back and that he didn't know where she'd gone.
Joe Shepherd was booked for assaulting a police officer, but he made bond and was released. For several days following Roxanne's disappearance, over 60 people searched the woods looking for her. Shepherd voluntarily joined them. The police brought in dogs to follow Roxanne's scent into the woods. They tracked her only a few yards, and then the trail abruptly stopped. Roxanne's family feared the worst.
There's no relief because you haven't got her. She's gone. You don't know what's happened to her. And she's out there and you can't reach her. And you can't help her.
After a few frustrating days, the search was called off. But an unexpected discovery would soon bring authorities back to Joe Shepherd's house.
Joe's mother was standing at the window in the kitchen looking out, and she noticed that the dogs were digging and going on at one specific location there. And she walked up on what proved to be two hands sticking out of the ground. She notified the authorities at that time, and they came to the Shepherd home and did remove the body of Roxanne Woodson from Joe Shepherd's mother and father's yard.
Roxanne had been buried in a shallow grave. Some of her clothes were missing, and her pants had been wrapped around her head.
At that point, the Monroe County Sheriff's deputy took out a warrant charging the suspect, Joe Shepherd, with first-degree murder.
Look here, Joe. Found her buried in your front yard. Look at him, Joe. We found her buried in your yard.
During Shepherd's second interrogation, his story began to change.
Tell us the truth, what happened to her.
I come up on her and she had hit her head or something. I tried to revive her. I thought maybe she's just knocked out. You know, something could happen to her out there, animal or something, so I thought I'll bury her. That's what I'll do. So I did. I took her back to the house and buried her.
According to Joe Shepherd, not knowing what to do with her in his previous encounters with the law, he was afraid to contact any law enforcement, so then he decided to bury her. He never did actually admit to being responsible for her death.
I find probable cause. Shepherd's explanation was not convincing. He was arraigned on a charge of murder. Authorities believed that they were on track to close the Woodson murder. Then they received an anonymous phone call linking Shepherd to yet another disappearance. Kathy Clowers, a local 14-year-old girl, had vanished 2 years earlier.
I need you to take us and show us where she is now. Can you do that?
Yeah, I can take you there.
Shepherd led investigators to the body of Kathy Clowers, just as he had promised.
We went into the woods, probably a couple hundred yards off of the highway. Joe had designated a spot where we ought to dig. I'll never forget Joe Shepherd was hunkered down beside the hole we were digging, and he looked up with his cold smile on his face and said, "See, I told you so." He was proud, I think, of the fact that he had produced a body for us and showed no emotion at all. A pants leg had been wrapped around her head, very similar to the manner in which the Woodson child had been buried. There had been a pants leg wrapped around her head.
Joe Shepherd was formally indicted for the murder of Kathy Clowers. While he awaited trial, one of the jailers was summoned to a cell near Shepherd's.
What's the matter with you, boy?
The jailer was lured into the cell by a prisoner pretending to be sick.
What's your problem?
I don't know, I'm sick.
After locking up the jailer, the two men went to Shepherd's cell. They released him and the three fled the prison.
Let's go! Come on, hurry up, boy!
The other two escapees were recaptured the following week, but Shepherd remained at large. Update. London, Ontario, Canada. Thanks to a viewer tip, a 10-year search for Joe Shepherd has ended.
After the Unsolved Mystery show on October the 5th, we received a phone call from a local resident saying that he believed the guy called Shepherd was in fact living in London under the name Joseph Tripp. We began an investigation, and when we had identified him to our satisfaction as Shepherd, he was arrested.
Shepard was later extradited and convicted of involuntary manslaughter in the death of Kathy Clowers and felony murder in the death of Roxanne Woodson. Joe Shepard was sentenced to life in prison for the murders. Next, can a deceased loved one communicate from beyond the grave? Portsmouth, Virginia. It was 3 months after the birth of Michelle O'Malley's son, Benjamin. That evening, Michelle had a haunting dream about a conversation with her deceased grandfather. He appeared with a message for his son, Greg, Michelle's father.
Michelle, tell Greg to get a pail of water and meet me at the railroad track.
First, I thought it was just one of those things where I must have had him on my mind and, you know, thinking it was just a dream. And I asked my dad, I said, what did he mean by this?
And I was just stunned. I didn't say anything. She says, does that make any sense? I says, it makes perfect sense.
Now, Greg, one of the one things we got to watch out for.
And I remembered back when I was a child, he had asked me on Labor Day to go fishing with him.
Let's take a look at this.
And I remember taking the pail and caught an eel.
Yes, we got another one!
Great, fantastic!
And my job was to carry it back in the pail. Wonderful. And it was kind of a scary thought. I mean, this thing squirming around on this pail, walking back with it. Michelle had no way of knowing that. I became a believer at that point.
One of the most fascinating evidences of life after death contained in direct contacts is the fact that loved ones who have passed on will often, through particularly vivid dreams, tell us little bits of information, tell us things that we could not possibly know.
Oh, Michelle, I'm so happy you named him Benjamin.
Over time, Michelle's dreams began to feel more and more real. Michelle actually appeared in some dreams herself, talking with her grandfather.
Michelle. Ask Greg if he knows where your uncle's purple heart is.
What purple heart, Grandpa?
When I asked my father about the purple heart, my dad was like, no, Michelle, you know, none of my uncles, not that I know, have had a purple heart.
And one day I happened to be speaking to my mother, and I asked her about it. And she says, oh, yeah. She says, your uncle had gotten a purple heart, and she had it.
The dreams began to take Michelle to places she had never been before, places where her grandfather had spent some of the happiest days of his life.
Grandpa! Grandpa!
We're late for the track. I'm sorry, honey, you have to go back. Now go on home, but tell Greg I got his lucky pencil.
I thought, now I'm really losing it. This did not make sense whatsoever. So I called Dad. When I told him about the lucky pencil, Dad just sat there again on the phone, and he was real quiet. And he told me that when he was a little boy, they used to all go to the racetrack.
Lucky pencils! Get your lucky pencils!
My mom had a box of pencils, little stubs and full-length ones, and I took that down off the shelf, and I stood at the gate of the racetrack and sold lucky pencils.
Lucky pencils! Get your lucky pencils! I can buy a lucky pencil!
I couldn't imagine how she was picking these things up, because we had never talked about it. And there would be no way for her to know these things.
Michelle had named her baby Benjamin after her grandfather. I believe that's the reason Grandpa came back to her. It was a way of affirming that he's there. It was a way also of saying, thank you. Hey, that's nice. Just the way if somebody here on Earth named a child after you, you'd say, well, thank you. How flattering.
He's such a good baby.
He said he will always watch over me and Benjamin. So in a way, I look at it as a guardian angel.
More than 100 dreams later, Michelle O'Malley still looks forward to each encounter with her grandfather.
I just kind of look at it as a blessing, a gift. One thing he did tell me was that I was going to help a lot of people with my story. And I don't know how I'll know that, but I believe him, because when Grandpa speaks, I listen.
Michelle is not alone. Many people say they've had some form of communication with the dead, often through dreams. It's the kind of experience that is unbelievable until it happens to you. Previously on our show, we profiled the case of Elmer DeBoer, an oil company courier who was murdered execution style. The two key suspects were Jerry Strickland and his 16-year-old girlfriend, Missy Monday. Police believe the couple kidnapped Elmer, robbed him of $10,000, and then took him to a deserted area and murdered him. Jerry and Missy disappeared after the murder. Update. Within minutes of our broadcast, 20 viewers in the small community of Moses Lake, Washington, called police to say that they recognized Jerry Strickland and Missy Monday. Police later arrested the fugitive couple at a friend's house. They had watched the broadcast and were waiting for the police.
All he said is, "I'm the guy you're looking for." And he was just real calm and collect. No violence at all.
I figure the time was about 7 hours and 15 minutes from the time the Unsolved Mysteries aired and he was in custody. I just felt super about it.
Strickland insisted that he and Missy Monday were innocent.
They got circumstance of evidence. All hearsay. It's people talking, but no witnesses. I mean, okay? That's why, you know, I say they're gonna learn that we didn't do this.
We have enough evidence, circumstantial evidence and physical evidence, that we feel he's guilty.
All they want is a conviction, and they don't care if they burn me or not.
Jerry Strickland was convicted of kidnapping and murder. His sentence was 2 life terms without the possibility of parole. Strickland's girlfriend, Missy Monday, testified against Strickland and was released after 7 months in juvenile detention.